everybody, and welcome. This is NBL Overtime, all thanks to LD Mobile. And after the better part of, well, it felt like 5 years, it was actually around 10 months, we are back. Round one is in the books, upsets galore, but of course the best action in the world of basketball in our backyard. Hashtag NBL Overtime to get involved. Deep breath. Because today is the last day. Tonight is the last night. We've got no NBL for the better part of 2 weeks. We're going to get very shortly to round three. There is so much ball happening. My man, hello to you. What's going on?
What's going on? Let's do it. Plenty to get into. Let's go.
You got headphones in here?
Oh, man. Okay. I forgot.
I thought it was funny. A fashion statement.
No. I can hear you loud and clear.
Good, I know you can hear me. There we go. Hello to you, Liam Santa Maria, studs and duds. Check it out, nbl.com.au. Hello, my man.
Hello. What a massive opening round. We're finally underway. Upsets, big games, the double overtime classic, I over dribble, Corey over dribble.
Yeah. We do. I know we're a little loose, but we do have a license we have to kind of live under.
Okay.
I'll stop you before you go to. Right. That would have been a great reenactment, though. But that gave us a fair bit of amusement, and it worked because Connor Henry and the crew were able to bounce back a couple of days later, which we'll get to very shortly. I've got to take another deep breath now because you've worried me. You can get involved at home wherever you are, but we're going to start with the Hawks. Of course, an off-season, some uncertainty with the financial situation, the change of ownership, and then they go and get the GOAT. Brian Goorjian comes in. They put towards really a really good crew. They win on opening night. They've got injuries to two of their main men, in particular their number one guy. And then they smack Cairns. Let's start with the Hawks. I know you've been big on them. You are excited. We've all been pumped to see the way they played their basketball. They're 2-0, and Liam Santa Maria last night gave us that stat for the first time in franchise history in week one. Brisbane, Cairns, smacked around. Talk to me, Homicide.
Dory spoke to me in the offseason and told me, I got something big for you. I'm bringing my guy back, Brian Goorjian. And we're going to do this. And we're coming in to win. We're not coming to compete. We're coming to win. They put a team together at the last stages of before the season. So they were under the pump before this season was supposed to begin to get the roster. They did an incredible job at the last minute. And we're seeing it. Never discount a team that Brian Goorjian is coaching. Justinian Jessup, my young brother, Dre Calloway, told me in the state of Colorado since high school, this kid was a bucket getter. As we know, he got drafted the next star by Golden State in the second round. Simon says so. Energy, effort, and intensity. That's what he brings. And an attitude with it. Shout out to Simon says so. And Tyler Harvey, there ain't nowhere in the planet he can't get a bucket. From the Kmart side in the first quarter? That's just a bucket getter. So then you add in, Dana Dell ain't even play yet. Bear still getting his legs up on them. Greeter and Nah compliment pieces to this team. A.J. Ogilvy doing great as well in the limited roles. This team is rolling, and it's earliest great signs so far. I know it's round one. Mm-hmm. I know it's two games, but this is how you want to start off the first round in the NBL.
100%, and so much of it is about how they're playing. You know, we know they've got the horses. A lot of these teams have the horses, but how do you bring it together? And the way the Hawks came out at both ends of the floor, Justin Simon setting the tone defensively, and then yeah, shout out Emmett Nahr and Sam Froehlich for what they brought at the offensive end against the Bullets. And then Jessup and Harvey in particular offensively in the snag pit. I mean, you have to be locked in on those two, possession after possession, or they'll get their confidence flowing and they'll kill you. And the Taipans learnt that the hard way.
You mentioned all the big names. You mentioned Froehlich and Nahr. In particular, Nahr on Saturday's game against the Bullets was brilliant. Right towards the end of that first quarter, when just taking a little roll on for the Taipans, Isaac White comes on and just keeps the ball alive a couple of times. Of course, he was able to keep it alive with that steal and find Harvey for that Kmart logo splash right on quarter time. And that's what you're going to get. We're not surprised that Brian Goorjian's team is going to be hard 40 minutes a game, but the crew they've assembled, as you touched on, is perfect for the style, and they've all bought in. They've been on the road for a month now, which is not unique, unfortunately, to NBL 21, but from early signs, when Brian Goorjian said, you either make it work for us or we don't, and all the things right now looks like it's working. And they are fun. They are so fun to watch.
They really are. They're super fun to watch. And I tell you what, Justin Simon, let's go back and talk about him a little bit more, because what he did for them, really at both ends of the floor. I mean, I think it was so important for him at the start of that game against Brisbane, his NBL debut. They leave him wide, wide open a couple of times and he knocks them down. And now he feels great. Gets after it defensively. Stat sheet stuffer supreme. Record-breaking stuff. And his play towards the end of the third quarter last night in Cairns, they were whacking the Taipans around. But all of a sudden, the Snakes started getting themselves back into the game. 7-point game, less than a minute to go in that third term. Things could have got interesting, and he made the play of the game defensively. He puts the fire out on Oliver on the roll, closes out Majuk Deng, blocks the 3-point shot, and then converts down the other end. Those kind of plays are enormous, and he made that big one against the Snakes.
I don't know how he got that block. I don't know how he was able to recover to get a hand on it and change it, but you're right, they were great. The Hawks are great and the fans are growing each and every minute. I love a good bandwagon, and I think people right around the country, of course the Hawks fans are always on it, but I think fans around the country, even two games in, are understanding how fun they are going to be watching in 2021. All right, let's talk Josh Giddey. Next start, we made a great deal of him in the off-season and he did not disappoint opening weekend, of course. A nasty, scary incident late in this win against South East Melbourne Phoenix, so we won't see him in the rematch tomorrow night. But everything he did, Homicide, you've been raving about him. You love Next Stars. You're a mentor. I'm not going to say official, I'll say the unofficial mentor, but everything you would have seen, you liked.
I mean, I loved what I saw. This kid has heart. He has confidence. He's ready to go. For me, give him the keys to the car. Let him run the show. It's his time. It's his turn. And he showed it. Coach, give me the ball down the stretch. DJ fouls out after an incredible performance. However, they go to double overtime. Look at that. Look at that block. Great athleticism. Great defense. He's making plays like this. He's 18 years old. We saw this last season, right? We saw this with Melo, right? Great. This is what he saw Melo do. So now he knows if he has the opportunity, which he has, I can do this too. Showed heart, showed courage. The spin cycle move on Cam Glidden and one. Clutch bucket.
With the left.
Come on, man. That's that stuff 18-year-olds do.
They're different breeds, 18-year-olds now, though.
They're definitely different breeds, man. And he was making the plays down the stretch that you would see veterans make. He can turn the corner. You got to guard him. If not, he's going mid-range bucket. He can turn the corner because of his size and length. So the double has to come. He makes the right decisions, and he's going to make high-percentage plays. Sky's the limit for him. He's only going to get better. I'm going to enjoy watching him. Look at this. This is Mitch Creek he's going up against. He finishes aggressive.
Kind of tough to watch, still.
You know what? He's tough. He'd be all right.
Yeah.
And it's the toughness showed out to me the most. We knew about the skill and the talent and the playmaking, but that was an incredible fall. And then to pull this out of your bag in double overtime after that's, you've just fallen on your face from a great height in your second professional game was really, really special. And, you know, it was a beautiful Australian kind of moment because it was the type of grit and toughness that we are known for on the hardwood. And geez, I mean, I was really worried for him when he was coming down on his face. I mean, it looked, I tweeted this, it looked a little like the Andrew Bogut, Amar Stoudemire, if he had to come down a little bit slightly differently. So to just bounce back like he did, like the Plastic Man, and then get back into it was incredibly impressive. Ruled out for the rematch, sadly, but boy, did he have an impressive debut weekend.
How many triple-doubles will he have?
He'll have one or two.
I agree. He'll have one or two.
All right. While Josh Giddey was great, and he's not playing this or Wednesday night, tomorrow night, their imports are going to have to fire. Sluggish start for both Americans as we kickstart NBL 21. Now, did it hurt them in the end against South East Melbourne Phoenix? It didn't. Daniel Johnson was remarkable. Humphries was brilliant. Giddey, as we touched on, was good. But if this team is to do some damage and surprise a lot, I'll start with you, Liam.
Yeah.
They're going to have to be coming a lot better, a lot faster than they were on the weekend.
Yeah, it was a slow start for their imports, Sloan and Crocker. I mean, they showed a little bit. Crocker, he can shoot it. He can really shoot it. We know that from what he's done previously. And but look, you could see like he got a little flat tire here on the breakaway. Looked a little awkward. And They didn't really stamp their authority on games in the kind of moments that they needed to. A big bucket from Sloan late in overtime in this Southeast Melbourne Phoenix Classic. And, you know, like, they're going to need to come in and show a little bit more game after game if Adelaide are going to get more and more wins. And they're going to have a big opportunity. Sloan's going to need to come in and be super aggressive tomorrow night against the Phoenix. Giddey's not going to be there to make those plays. The ball's going to be in his hands. And that's the bucket I'm talking about. That was a big one in the first overtime. And he's going to need to really take the mantle tomorrow night with Giddey out.
Who's the primary ball handler of this team as the season develops?
Giddey.
And does that play away from Sloan's strengths?
You know, he's going to need to embrace that. Mm. That's the reality of it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, I know it's round one. I'm not going to jump the gun. These guys haven't played in a long time. There's a lot of rust. They've come out of quarantine after 2 weeks. But he's definitely going to have... Donald Sloan's going to have to step his game up. He knows this. He's a pro. He's played in the league. He's played many games. He knows he didn't have a good week. So he's going to have a big game coming up in round two. Game or two games, whatever it is. Crocker bounced back in the second game, and he played well. He's a gun. He's going to play both ends of the court really tight, and they're really going to have to lift their games because it can't be DJ every night. We know this. DJ's averaging, what, 30 points a game over two games. It can't be him every night. It's going to be him, but he's going to need help, as we saw in game one versus Melbourne United. You're going to have to step it up and step it up quick.
Because as great as Daniel Johnson was, as great as I thought Humphries was, and as great as Giddey was, Southeast Melbourne Phoenix keep shooting themselves in the foot. We know they're a three-point shooting team as well, and they're not going to continually shoot that bad, wide-open looks as a year. So they kind of, as great as those three guys were, they kind of got away with one. It took double overtime to get there, and you still got to win the game, but Southeast Melbourne Phoenix as a three-point percentage, and the freebies they left, I think it was 14 or 15, tomorrow night, we're looking straight to tomorrow night where they rematch, you'd expect that Simon Mitchell's crew is going to be able to knock a couple of those wide opens down and also for 15 foot.
Yeah, I think if you're the Phoenix, if you're the Phoenix fans, you're pretty frustrated with that loss. Like you say, they shoot 8 for 30 from 3. Cam Glidden, 3 of 13. This guy shot 40% from 3 last season, and he shot the ball from long range very well over the course of his career. He just didn't get enough up last year in Brisbane. Well, the job for the Phoenix is to get him those open looks. They did that in game one. He just didn't knock enough of them down. Ruben Tarangi similarly. And then to leave 14 points on the free throw line, they really handed that game away. And let's not move on from the Adelaide 36ers with just a couple of little tiny mentions of Daniel Johnson, because he was incredible.
Easy.
67% he scored those 60 points at from the field. 19 of 21 from the free throw line. In year 13, just has been great for so long and continuing to get it done.
Well, he's the most underrated NBL superstar for the decade, right? Like, when we broke down the numbers of the decade in NBL overtime 12 months ago, he was at the top. Now, of course, there's that narrative around, should he have played more boomers? That's a conversation we've all had at different times. But the very fact is, even on the weekend, we're talking more about Giddey for the obvious reasons. Isaac Humphries played really well, and I think we'll only get better. But the very fact is that they won that game, in particular because of Daniel Johnson's first half. Mm. And it almost works perfectly with the narrative around his career. We talk about other people more so than the fact that he opened NBL 21 in the way that he did. And he is, in my mind, the most underrated superstar this league's had for the decade.
He was incredible this weekend. Literally, just jump on my back. Let me just do what I got to do. But I look forward to seeing him do that. I need more rebounds from you. Offensively, you are great. I need you to average a double-double this year. That's my challenge to you. 10-plus rebounds a game.
And tomorrow night, the rematch. Phoenix, they need to work out a way to deal with Daniel Johnson. And that needs to be Mitch Creek putting his hand up and saying, you know what? I'm shutting my former teammate down tonight.
He will be Defensive Player of the Year, Mitch Creek, so it'll be a nice time to be able to prove my prediction. All right, Southeast Melbourne Phoenix went to Adelaide, didn't get it done. They got a chance tomorrow, as we know. Melbourne United did. Rolled in Friday night, close at halftime. Interesting starting five to kickstart the third quarter with two superstars sitting on the pine. but it worked. They went bang. Their second half was magical. And a lot of what we've been able to see already in one game, at least in the actual season for Melbourne United, is probably fits in the idea of many around the league. I'll start with you, Homicide. What'd you make of this crew?
This team is stacked. First half, it was a tightly contested contest. They were down. Dean Vickerman, Shaeli, let's go. Sets the tone defensively, and they got rolling. And let me tell you something. Jock Landale loved his work. Joe Alakchu, off the bench. Listen,
hey, my,
that's the black hole.
Hey,
he's not passing. I love his aggression, but he is not passing. I love his aggression.
Hey, my prediction for most improved.
CG43 set the tone in the first half.
He did.
And it carried over. The ball kept moving. Jack White, five people in double figures. And you see plays like that. And that's what we're going to see from him. Being able to run the floor, hit the three, rebound, play defense. Look, he's going after this to the NBA. We're just happy that he's here. Jack White loved his energy. Defensively, he was there, 7-7. And the man from Japan, off the bench.
Yes.
Welcome to Australia and the NBL. 10 points in 17 minutes off the bench. I was loving what I was seeing. And Scotty Hobson didn't even get busy that day. That's the thing about this team. They're so deep. Doesn't even have to be a night. Just play your position. Beautiful.
And this is why I'm, you know, I, along with everyone else, is so high on this team this year. And it's not just that they're stacked. It's that we can see it's going to come together and fit together. Right? Because we talk about the superstars coming into the season, Mitch McCarron, Chris Golding, Jock Landale, Scotty Hobson, but they've got some other key pieces that are going to be really important for them, because Shaeli and Joe Lualachu, Udeh Bubba, their impact defensively off the bench changed that game.
Yep.
And Dean Vickerman knew it. That's why he made that change at the start of the second half. The ability to say, you know what, Chris, Jock, we've got buy-in from everyone. You're coming off the bench to open the half, we're going to ramp things up defensively, and then you're going to come in and break their neck. And that's exactly what they did. So they've set the tone right from the start of the year. Nobody be a prima donna. No, put check the ego at the door. We got to do what we got to do to win games or win the title. And they've got the talent to get that done.
Shaeli's the big one, as you mentioned there. I think last year he struggled at different times to be able to find the comfort level needed. And then he had that amazing semi-final when they changed the starting lineup late in the year. He was great on Casper Ware, he had a great series. Now in the end, they didn't quite get over the hump. But I think the confidence and the momentum has obviously travelled into the off-season, and now it's translated into NBL 21. And I'm not sure if it was you, Liam, or someone on Twitter, and I apologise if it wasn't you and it was someone at home. Someone said that if we see the Tall Blacks Shaeli, he's going to be a monstrous problem for anyone trying to take on Melbourne United. That's what I felt like watching the game on Friday night.
Well, when Vickerman turns to that Illy McCarron backcourt combination, it's a nightmare.
Good luck scoring.
A few minutes at the defensive end for their opposition. And that really was what set the tone and changed the game. So he has that big ace up his sleeve.
Now, obviously, with the NBL 21 back, hashtag NBL 21 to get involved. So are the top 10 plays of the week. All thanks to LD Mobile.
The new season has begun. Let's have some fun at your Aldi Mobile NBL Top 10. At number 10, Jordan Hunter slips the screen, then gets obscene. Sean Bruce sends him to the roof with the alley-oop, and Hunter brings the truth for the Kings, getting them in at number 10. Moving along to number 9, where the Hawks have the defensive stopper who's a legit shot blocker. Simon says no to Scott Machado, and that gets in at number 9. More defense at number 8. No, it's not the great Chris Golding with the steal. Check it out. Oh my gosh! The superstar kid says uh-uh to Udeh Bubba. A defensive gem gets in at number 8. On to number 7, and it's Justin Simon with a little behind the back on the perimeter to leave the defense froze. Then he's taking his Zapatos straight to the hole for the hammer throw as the Hawks rise again at the rim for number 7. At number 6, sometimes you need some basketball skills, and sometimes you just need to get the rock to a jock. Udeh setting up the number 6 play as Landale flies well. It's Jock back home with the alley-oop at the throne for Melbourne, getting in at number 6. On to number 5, and the sun rises in the east, the sun sets in the west, And when Space Camp's involved, the highlights are the best. The natural order is restored. Space Camps prevent the score. And memo to Craig Mahler, Cam Oliver's a baller as he swats that shot at number five. At number four, we're in overtime as Josh Giddey goes flying. Giddey up for the stuff, and all of Adelaide manages a big sigh of relief as after that landing, the kid was back on his feet. Even with a taste of the floor, Josh Giddey gets in again at number four. Brisbane gets in at number three, and do you like out-of-bounds plays? Well, this one's no gimmick. It's Big Law bringing the truth from Anthony Drimmick. You can't go above the law when Vic's on the ball. He's flying high at number three. We're up to number two, and with time winding down late in the game, it's Tyler Harvey who's bringing the pain. The decisive rebound throwdown allows the Hawks to leave town with the win and get in at number two. But at number one, Adelaide gets played. Yanni Wetzel gets the steal and then proves he's got the feel. The pretzel is hot and he's got more range than a cell tower as he brings the three-point shower from beyond half court to land at number one on the NBL.
Absolutely, absolutely not a setup. We love Yanni. He was brilliant, 23 and 10. We haven't mentioned him
24.
Too much. 24 and 10. Sorry, big dog. 24 and 10, he was brilliant. But we'll definitely talk a lot of Yanni Wetzel over the course of the season. But firstly, Santa's watching. Take it.
Let's start in Adelaide. Coach Henry was involved in all kinds of ways. This is Shaili, of course, just throwing the tip. But bang! Oh, boy. Early contact on the sidelines. And then let's go in the huddle, boys. Let's go in the huddle.
Oh, my goodness.
Because a couple of guys were
over. Here he comes.
Including someone who wasn't even out there on the floor, which was a bit rough.
bit rough.
This is Deng Deng wasn't happy with his early productivity, clearly, and neither was Anthony Drimmick, having a tough time on the hardwood. Especially the frolling battle was fun in all kinds of different ways as Big Harry got into the hair and broken mop out there on the floor in the snag pit. Didn't the snag pit look good?
It looked great
over the weekend, boys. And the chairman of the boards,
chairman
Corey.
Chairman of the boards.
Look at the swag.
Loves it.
From the chairman, Phil Smythe. Doesn't quite have the same rhythm, but he enjoyed it nonetheless. And Mitch Creek forgot he doesn't play for the 36ers anymore. The whole household getting involved, Adam Gibson. And here's Josh Giddey just trying to be COVID safe. He said, I got my own one, coach, but cheers, we got to win. And let's get stuck into the rest of the season.
There we go. Santa's watching. Of course, sometimes he needs the little elves at home. So make sure you hit him up at Liam_Santa, is it?
Correct.
On Twitter to help him out. All right, let's start the Sydney Kings. They played a really good game and they'll have a rematch this weekend against the Cairns Taipans. I see that Ware and Didi Lazada made your duds and studs and duds. Make sure you check it out on nbl.com.au. But let's start with the big man, Martin, because 11-8 off the bench, minutes restriction. But he was pretty good from what we're able to see homicide, even though we want to see a little more of him. And no doubt he wants to play a little bit more, but just out of quarantine not too long ago on a bit of a restriction there. But it looks like someone is going to be able to help them.
Look, he is legit. And I'm pretty sure come round two, round three, he'll be full throttle. That young man has some serious game. I've seen enough with the little bit of minutes to know he is going to be a matchup problem. And that's all I got. I just can't wait to see him play more minutes.
I'm fascinated to see how they handle him in the rematch this Saturday night up there in Cairns, because 2 weeks out of quarantine, it'll be 3 weeks by that time. They'll have got 15 minutes into him in that opening game. Now, they're just trying to make sure that they get him through the opening couple of games with him not going down. They nearly won the ball game despite the limited minutes, which would have been an enormous result for them and a great celebration. But for sure, he showed in that time what he's going to be capable of. So did Dion Vasiljevic, made a bunch of big plays in big moments and kept the scoreboard ticking over. But yeah, Casper Ware, I loved what I saw out of him. See this type of aggression from Vasiljevic? I want to see more of that from Casper. That's when he's at his absolute best. And we saw that early doors. Here's more and more of the other guys making plays, and Jordan Hunter stepped in and played some good minutes, but Didi Lizarda needs to get more involved. He was a little bit on the back foot, a little bit quiet, needs to be a little bit more assertive. And Casper, get those 2 feet in the paint, the floaters, the pull-ups, to the free throw attempts, and just park the three ball for once you've got your juices flowing.
And, of course, Casper Wu was involved in the last play of the game. In fact, the last two play of the game, and didn't take long for controversy and social media to fire up. Talk us through this homicide. What did you make of it watching it live?
Well, watching it, I felt he was really aggressive. And that foul, to me, was on the floor. Mm-hmm. But it looked like it can go both ways, but to me, it was on the floor.
So, Liam, just explain it. So when it's reviewed in the NBL, it's based on where, watching the vision, the foul occurs, not when the whistle is blown, to which social media is blowing up because that is actually the opposite of what the NBA rule is,
correct.
Right?
Yeah, when the foul occurred. So that's what they had to look at. Heads up play from Casper.
Yep.
Because he heard Mike Kelly yelling foul to give, and he felt the contact early, knew Scott was going to come in and shove him, and almost got the timing perfectly right. Just a split second difference. They ended up having to take it from the side, and then he got a good look.
Got a real good look.
Got a pretty good look for the game winner, and that one came off the iron. So, geez, as I said, it would have been a spectacular result, and you know we're on the Kings a little bit here in a variety of different ways. But look, I got some alarm bells ringing about the Taipans. They snuck over the line there, but the loss of DJ Newball, especially at the defensive end, you could see the impact in a big way in that opening round.
They were out energized last night by the Hawks, and yet again we'll stress it. Gorge's team is going to play hard for 40 minutes. So it won't be the only team this year that they're actually able to out-hustle and win those big kind of moments. But that's something that the Cairns Taipans last year prided themselves on, being able to feed off the energy. Now, we're in the snag pit compared to the traditional stadium, but the energy just seemed a little bit, in particular last night, to be lower than what it was last year when they were playing such great basketball.
Well, what they were missing was their stopper on the wing. Because last year, DJ Newball, you put him on Justinian Jessup. He's not cheating around any of those screens off the ball. We saw that when he guarded Bryce Cotton at various times throughout the year and other elite scoring wings. And they didn't have that. They had Quatnoy on Justinian Jessup. He's slipping under. Jessup's flaring. Whap. He gets going early in the first quarter and they never look back.
Now, off the top of the show, I said, enjoy tonight. Take a big, deep breath because this is, in fact, the last night for the better part of almost 2 weeks. We won't have NBL action because round 3 has been released today. There you go. It starts on Australia Day, which I think's a great day. Nice little afternoon game there. The Bullets and the Kings. We'll see Adelaide and New Zealand as the Breakers start to get into it. We'll look at round 2 in a moment. Cairns and Hawks again going at it as well. That's going to be great. And, of course, for the Victorian fans, we're going to see the first game of Victoria as well at Bendigo with the throwdown, United and Phoenix.
We get a chance to see the New Zealand Breakers. Mm-hmm. And Perth Wildcats. Mm-hmm. So I'm excited to see both of those teams. And at one point in that round, they play each other.
Ooh, yeah. Just for people at home, that is obviously round 3 that's been released. So this is round 2. Let's have a little look and talk a little more about what's going to see a little earlier. Of course, tomorrow night, I think you and I, Liam, are going to be in the commentary booth for that one today. You see the rematch, the 36ers and the Phoenix. And it's just full. I love the rematch idea. I like them going up against each other fairly quickly. As you touched on, we'll see Perth for the first time this year and New Zealand for the first time in NBL 21. What game are you most looking forward to in round 2?
I'm going to say Cairns. No. I'll say Perth and against the Phoenix.
I'm with you, actually, because Perth, you know, a little bit of media, of course. A lot of people suggesting this could be the end of their run. So that chip on the shoulder, of course, we know how good they are. So there we go.
Yeah, and for me, I think it's Adelaide and New Zealand because for similar reasons, our first chance to get a good look at this Breakers squad, Lamar Patterson in the Breakers jersey. But you're right, I like the little mini series. We get to see Cairns and Sydney go back at it, that one-point thriller they played. And also, we get to see Brisbane and the Hawks get back at it because the Bullets, they shot themselves in the foot a little bit as well.
Like what you did there. Was that pun intended or accident?
Oh, I nailed it.
Oh, did you? There you go. You know what I like to do? Scrunch up my basketball. Good job.
Good work.
Hashtag NBL Overtime to get involved. Hashtag NBL 21. basketball, two consecutive weeks. Get involved wherever you might be right around the country at the NBL. See ya.